Good morning, students, and welcome back to the class. So in our previous class, we have studied about the Renaissance and what is its impact. So among the impacts of Renaissance, we have studied that there was a great change in the kind of art that was happening. There was also a change in the the sculptors. The sculptors have also adapted new strategies. They came out of the medieval age practices and they started doing more advanced things. So continuing with this impact, Renaissance led to the use of local languages instead of Latin as in the medieval age. So in the medieval ages, Latin language was forced on these people. So now, because of Renaissance or rebirth, what happened? The importance of local languages again increased. And the authors of this period wrote on various aspects of human life. That is, the importance of local languages became more again, and the authors who use different kinds of languages to write these books, they have also shifted the kind of topics they write. So earlier, they used to write on spiritual themes, that means about God, the kind of rituals, the practice, these kind of things were more. But now there was more about human life. The books written by authors had changed, had seen a change in pattern, or had seen a shift of topic or content. That is, from spiritual themes to human life. So the topic of writing books was also shifted. Earlier it was spiritual themes, like God and his rituals and other things, but now it has shifted to human life. They tried to highlight problems faced by man. So in those books, authors generally wrote about the problems faced by man. So thus, authors' writing also has seen a shift during Renaissance, or you can say this is a kind of impact on people who are like authors and all. The Renaissance spirit encouraged scientific observation and experimentation. So as I said, questioning and other things have rationalization, human thinking and all were slowly increasing among people. It also encouraged scientific observation and experimentation. So that means thinking anything which is practiced during medieval age has been looked in a questioning manner. So they started questioning the concepts of the medieval ages. They observed them with scientific mind, and they started experimentation of those things. So when they experimented those things, it led slowly to new discoveries. Okay, so it led mainly to new inventions as well as discoveries. Some of these discoveries challenged the existing church beliefs. So people with scientific mind, when they started understanding the concepts in a different manner, that is with scientific mind, then new inventions came up and new discoveries also happened. Because of these new inventions and new discoveries, there was a lot of change in society. The new inventions and new discoveries also questioned the practices of church. Earlier, church has imposed certain kinds of beliefs. Now, because of these new inventions and discoveries, even the beliefs of church were questioned. For example, Copernicus, so a Polish astronomer means from Poland, in a country called Poland, he was an astronomer. So who deals about planets, the sky, galaxies and all. So the name of the astronomer was Copernicus. He proved that Earth revolves around the sun. By this, he challenged the old Christian belief that Earth was the center of the universe. So the scientific discovery called the sun is center of the Earth, and Earth revolves around the sun, was proved by an astronomer called Copernicus. So the discovery of Copernicus that Earth itself revolves around the Sun. He proved that Earth revolves around the Sun. But the church had propagated a belief called that the Earth is at the center of the universe and all other things revolve around it. This age-old belief was dismantled, or you can call questioned, or it was completely disproved by Copernicus, a great astronomer during the Renaissance period. That was one discovery which was very important. Later on, German scientist John Kepler. So what was his name? John Kepler. He was a German scientist. He proved that. So the discoveries of Kepler was Earth and other planets move around the Sun, not in a circle but elliptical orbit. So from here onwards, the scientific discoveries have become more and more. And Kepler found that the Earth and other planets are revolving around the Sun in an elliptical orbit. So what do you mean by elliptical orbit? It's a bit kind of oval shape, okay, not circular shape. So this is elliptical, and this you can call a circular shape. So Kepler proved that Earth's orbit around the Sun is elliptical. And Italian scientist, so another Italian scientist, Galileo. So you might know him for very famous discoveries. He invented the telescope. So you can see telescope of Galileo, which was invented during the times of Renaissance. He discovered that the Milky Way is made up of stars. So the discovery of Galileo was Milky Way. So that is, it is made up of a group of stars. So right, even Sun is a star. Such many stars are present in a Milky Way. And we also belong to one kind of Milky Way. So Galileo proved that Milky Way is a group of stars. And so the telescope which he invented was useful for observing the planets in the sky. And another important scientist of Renaissance was Sir Isaac Newton, discovered his famous laws of gravitation. So there is no special need, there is no need to introduce specially Sir Isaac Newton. So he discovered laws of gravitation. And another great scientist called John Gutenberg, he invented the printing press, which helped in spreading knowledge through books. So this Isaac Newton, Kepler, and Galileo, and the other person was like John Gutenberg, their inventions helped a lot during Renaissance period for the purpose of change in society. And the most significant discovery in the field of medicine was made by an English physician, William Harvey. So another great musician called William Harvey was a great person, and he discovered, he was an English physician. That means who deals with the, like the body and its anatomy and such things. He discovered how blood circulates from heart through arteries to various parts of body. So you all know that we have arteries and veins. So arteries supply blood to various parts of the body. This was discovered by William Harvey, a physician. And the architects of Renaissance period freed themselves from the medieval rules and traditions. So who are these architects? People who construct buildings and all. So these people also have come out of the medieval aged rules, and they started thinking in a very new way. So which helped the architectural growth also during the Renaissance period. So the architects have come out of their, they have come out of their medieval aged practices or medieval aged architectural style. And later on, they have constructed beautiful monuments, churches, monasteries. So these monasteries, you know that they are the places where this kind of monks and others live, and they wrote many books inside it and all. So, and palaces. So the architectural people, they have created new monuments, churches, monasteries and palaces with altogether new kind of thinking and presenting in the architecture. They blended various styles. Okay, so in architecture there will be different styles like Islamic style, Greek style, Roman style, and Byzantine architecture. See, if you take Islamic style, there will be tombs. Suppose if this is the construction, there will be always tombs kind of structure in Islam. So in Greek, there is one kind of pattern followed for architecture. In Roman architecture, if you see, there will be more pillars, right? So these are all, and Byzantine, so which is the Eastern Roman Empire. So in all these places, there is, if you take Islamic, it is kind of one architecture. Greek, there is a different Greek. You take a lot of sculptures will be statues and sculptors will, I mean, there'll be a lot of images, you know, what do you call, images will be there on the buildings and all. So this kind of Romans and Byzantine architecture, all such architecture was completely blended. That means they have mixed and they created a new style of architecture. So in medieval days, they never had such an opportunity to mix the architecture and to go for a new architecture. And St. Peter's Church in Rome is an excellent example of Renaissance architecture. It was designed and decorated by Michelangelo. So Michelangelo, he was the chief architect for St. Peter's Church in Rome. So that's how, these are all the impacts of Renaissance. So on one way, they have artists have got inspired and they have changed the way of painting, like Mona Lisa and all new kind of paintings came up. Architectural people like Michelangelo, they brought up, like they blended the style of Islamic, Greek, Roman and other architectural styles, and finally they could bring a marvelous example like St. Peter's Church in Rome. And also there was great impact from even the scientific world. So these all are the greatest impacts or the results of what you call the Renaissance. So then we will study another important topic called the Reformation. So what is Reformation? We have studied Renaissance, that means rebirth. What was present early? Rebirth, you can call it like earlier there was one kind of situation or practice. That practice has been completely left and a new kind of thing was created. That is called Renaissance. Reformation means bringing some changes in certain important areas. Let us see what are those changes that happened. The Reformation is the name given to a group of religious movements in the 16th century launched by Christians against the various drawbacks of the church. So from this we can understand that the practices of church have been questioned, or the drawbacks of the church have been questioned through movements. People were fed up with the practices of church, and what they did, they questioned the practices of churches and they have tried to reform the church. So to make it as a better institution, they have taken up several movements. Those religious movements are known as Reformation movements. So what exactly these religious movements have done, they have stopped the objectionable practices of the clergymen. So they have questioned these objectionable practices. What do you mean by objectionable practices? That means which cannot be followed, which are very difficult and which are very partial for people to follow, and the clergymen. So who are the clergymen? You can call them as the priestly class. So the church father and the other people who are associated with this church. So church has been questioned, and the questioning of church has resulted in Reformation. The main target of these movements was Pope, and the highest authority in the church hierarchy. So what was the target of these movements? They wanted the reformation process to begin from Pope. So Pope was the highest authority of Christians in those days. So like, you know, we call, suppose you take a church, okay, a particular church will have a father, and all the churches together in that area will be under a bishop. So like this, you know, there is a hierarchy, okay? So and this hierarchy, Pope stands at the highest level. So he is the highest head for all the Christians in the world. So the reformative movements, they targeted Pope. So that Pope can reform the church and its objectionable practices. Because of the people called like Pope and other bishops and fathers, church as an institution has become very, very objectionable. So people targeted Pope so that they can also change church. The Reformation broke out in a number of countries like England, France, Germany, and Czechoslovakia, Switzerland, and Scotland. So these are all the European countries where people have taken up a voice against the Pope as well as the church and its objectionable practices. So like England, France, right? So like England, France, Germany, Czechoslovakia, Switzerland, and Scotland. In all these countries, Reformation movements have, in a, they were like spreading, I mean, the Reformation movements were at its peak. They were asking the church to stop its objectionable practices. And though these movements did not share the same religious beliefs and rituals, yet they are collectively termed as Reformation because they were aimed at reforming then existing church. So the Reformation movements, so like, you know, in one place, suppose you take England, there is one kind of practices that was taken up by church, or you take France, or you take Scotland, there were different kinds of religious beliefs introduced by church. In different set of manner, the church used to interfere in different kinds of matters, and also it used to implement different kind of objectionable policies. Now, even though in different areas church has been practicing different beliefs, and people were fighting against that beliefs which are in their own area, it was collectively called as Reformation. So in England, it might be one problem with church. In Germany, the church might have implemented another set of beliefs where people fought for removal of that beliefs of from church hands. So in every place, in every country, the problem was different with church. Even though the problems were different, all these movements fought in these countries were together called Reformation movements because they were related to church. As the problem is as the problem is due to church and its policies, all such movements are called Reformation movements. And these movements created a split in Christian church between those who continued to remain loyal to Pope at Rome and those who broke away from the church at Rome. So, as some people started working against church in a religious movement, the form of religious movements, the people who rejected church and its practices are known as Protestants. These Protestants are a group of Christians who completely rejected the practices of church. And the other people who were still loyal with the church and its practices were called Catholics or Roman Catholics. That is, people who remained loyal to church are called Catholic Christians, and people who reject and object the practices of church are called Protestants. Thus, Christianity got split during Renaissance into two groups called Catholics and Protestants. So we just now learned that church was having some objectionable practices. So what are those practices? Let us see one by one, and those are the reasons we can say which led to Reformation. So if we can understand what are the practices that were done by church, we can say yes, because of these reasons people have protested against the practices of church and there was a great split in Christianity. Let us see what are those causes for the church to be reformed. People were highly dissatisfied with some of the practices of Catholic Church, like giving tithe. So church was giving a thing called tithe, that is 1/10 of their income, paying Peter's pence, a tax to build St. Peter's Church, and buying pardon certificates called indulgences. So the church used to collect a separate tax from people called tithe taxes. So everyone in that place have to pay 1/10 of amount of their income as tax. This tax was called tithe tax, so which was collected by church. You can imagine it was almost like a political center. Unlike kings, here the church collected, started collecting taxes. And how much they have to pay tax? It was almost 1/10 of their income. So 1/10 of the income was paid as taxes. And also paying Peter's pence, a tax to build St. Peter's Church. So you can see St. Peter's Church, which is being built here. I told you, this is the architecture built by Michelangelo. This is a beautiful architectural building or church built by Michelangelo during the Renaissance period. For construction of this church called St. Peter's Church at Rome, they collected Peter's penance, which is also a separate kind of tax, and buying pardon certificates called indulgences. This is a very peculiar habit. The church started issuing certain certificates called pardon certificates, called indulgences, for the sins committed. That is, if anybody commits sin, then they can go to church, and in church, if they pay some amount of money, then what happens is the church will issue a certificate, and in that certificate there will be mentioning that all the sins committed by that person has been pardoned. That means the God has forgiven all the sins. Like this, the people of church used to issue pardon certificates by taking money, which was a immoral practice committed by church. So this pardon certificates were also given, and the practice of giving church offices to highest bidders. So for money's sake, what they used to do, whatever the offices that are related to the affairs of church, they are trying to give that offices to highest bidders. So it became like a commercial business. So whoever pays a very premium amount of money, for them, they used to give a church office for they can operate the church office. So this kind of immoral practices were brought by church. And some corrupt practices like charging fees for every transaction in life, from birth to death, fees for the peace of the soul. So I'll just mention here what kind of corrupt practices did the church has done. So they started collecting money. They have become money centers. they started charging fees for all the events from life to death. If you take a person's life, I mean from his birth to death, for everything, church started collecting some fees. And they show a proper reason also for that. See, we will see what kind of fees they used to collect. See, they collected fees for the peace of soul. That means if anybody is having, they're worried, they have a lot of problems and all. They used to take money and say that we are giving you we are giving you peace for your soul, and fees for the souls of people dead long ago. So if any ancestors and all who were dead, they also says that, see, your ancestors were unhappy, even though they had died, they were unhappy. To make their souls more peaceful, if you pay this fees, we will conduct a ritual, and because of this ritual, your ancestors and elders who died, their souls will remain peace. This kind of fees was collected from people, and they also collected fee for the salvation of the soul. So what do you mean by salvation of the soul? The soul getting liberated and trying to find the truth or the ultimate God. And even for the liberation of the soul and this kind of reaching God, they collected fees. And pronouncing a marriage lawful or unlawful, even if any marriage issues come, suppose if they want to declare a marriage is legal, then they collect some fees and they announce that this marriage is lawful. And if they wanted to break the law marriage, then also they collect some fee and they will say that yes, from today onwards they both are separated. Some of the clergymen lacked proper education. So these clergymen are the priests or the church fathers or the next level hierarchical people in the churches. They lacked proper education, lived in luxury, and neglected the religious duties. Can you imagine how Jesus Christ started this teachings and all, and where this church has led to, where led Christianity, right? Did ever Jesus thought that these kind of practices will come into Christianity? He never thought, but this kind of fee collection and all was done by church. And Pope's interference in the political affairs was resented by the kings. So these popes, once they have become the masters of Christianity or the highest head of Christianity, they felt that there's nobody to question them. So what they did, they started interfering with the political affairs of the kings. So, and even kings started feeling very difficult with church. They were against the church because these priests started involving the political affairs. Especially Pope was interfering more with the political affairs. For example, when Pope Clement II interfered in the political affairs of French King Philip IV, the king forced the Pope to leave his headquarters at Rome and stay in Avignon in France. So there was an example for this. When Clement II, he was the Pope. Okay, Pope is the position name and Clement II is the name of the person. So when Pope Clement II was the head of the Christians, he interfered with the political affairs of French King, King Philip IV. And what King Philip did, the king forced the Pope to leave his headquarters at Rome and stay in Avignon in France. So as he was continuously interfering with the king and his political affairs, the king asked him to leave, go to Avignon, a place in France. Similarly, King Henry IV of England. So another example, King Henry IV of England took away the church lands, closed a number of monasteries, and took away their buildings, land, and money. So because of the political interference of the Pope in the affairs of England's king, who is called Henry IV. Henry IV was England king, and his political affairs was interfered by Pope, because of which he completely took away the financial aid of church. He took away the lands, closed a number of monasteries, took away their buildings, land and money, everything, so that he could control the church, because they are unnecessarily involving the affairs of kings and their political duties. The spirit of new learning and spirit of inquiry developed by Renaissance broadened the mental outlook of people, and they questioned everything, including the authority of Pope and the church practices. It is very simple. I said that the people during Renaissance period, they have a different outlook because of the scientific inquiry. Because of the scientific inquiry, people started questioning. What they started questioning? Authority of the Pope and church practices. With what authority the Pope is allowing this kind of church practices, like issuing pardon certificates, taking fee for soul liberation, all such things. People started understanding with a broad scientific mind, and they questioned them. And there is an example with Martin Luther King, who was a German clergyman and professor. We will see what he did. So this man, he was a professor of theology at the University of Wittenberg. So Martin Luther King, okay, so Martin Luther King, he was a professor of theology. So what do you mean by theology? Theology is a subject which deals about God, the beliefs and other practices with God. So it is about the study of God and his beliefs. So this kind of subject was called theology. And Martin Luther King at the University of Wittenberg, he was studying about these subjects. And what he did, he openly criticized the Pope and the church and launched a movement against the abuses in the church and the authority of Pope. So what this man, Martin Luther King, did, he questioned the practices of church very openly, and he also challenged the authority of Pope. With what authority the Pope is collecting taxes from people? With what authority the Pope is involving in the political affairs of king? All such things were questioned by this Martin Luther King, who was a professor of theology. And what is this? Counter-Reformation. By the term Counter-Reformation itself, you understand that there are some people who are against this reforming church. They feel that church is highest to them and they don't want to bring any changes to church. So they started some movements against this reform movements. Those were called Counter-Reformation. In order to restore the credibility of the Catholic Church, a large number of dedicated Christians, including some popes, introduced certain reforms within the church. This movement is known as Counter-Reformation. So that is, there are some popes who came later on as heads of Christianity, and they have introduced certain reforms, as they felt that yes, this is a time for the church to change. And see, just others have just pointed out the problems of the church, but the counter-reformers, they brought the reforms within the church, and that movement is known as Counter-Reformation. They changed certain practices and they corrected it. So let us see what are those. As a result of Counter-Reformation, different religious orders were founded. One of them was the Society of Jesus, founded by Ignatius Loyola, Spanish noble. It speedily gained recognition and it was successful in winning back more adherents in Europe, India, China, Africa, and the Americas. So, as a part of Counter-Reformation, they formed a Society of Jesus. So, under this Society of Jesus, okay, it was founded by a person by name Ignatius Loyola. He was a Spanish noble. So, he started reforming the church. how he started reforming the church by founding a society. That means he made certain people to come together and to discuss about certain various good things about church. So here, because of the efforts of Ignatius Loyola, he could win back more people to get convert into Christianity in Europe, India, China, Africa, and Americas. And another person by name, Saint Francis Xavier, he was a follower of Ignatius Loyola. He came to India and worked till his death. The selfless and dedicated service rendered by Jesus helped in restoring the credibility of the Roman Catholic Church. See, earlier the church was busy with practices like collecting fees, right? All such things were there. Now they have shifted to another new kind of practice called service. Like Saint Xavier, he was follower of Ignatius Loyola, and he came to India, Saint Xavier, and he helped poor people. Of course, he was converting people into Christianity, but he did a lot of service to make them to live in a better way. So this was called Counter-Reformation. So another important thing was voyages and discoveries. So the Renaissance spirit led to the revival of interest in geography and explorations. As I said, people were motivated scientifically. They went on voyages to discover new places. So they went on explorations, and geographically they were very active in those days. The men of this period began to doubt the well-accepted medieval belief that Earth was flat mass of land. So earlier people believed it that the Earth was flat and they could not travel. There is an end for Earth and all. But now these voyages and discoveries, they have changed the mindset of people, saying that they are not a flat mass of land, but it is a very it's a circular object moving around the sun. So these people, they went on voyages from one place to another place. You can see this map here. So this arrow marks, if you take the arrow mark part, then that was the voyage taken by Vasco da Gama. You can see this straight lines. So this all path was taken by Vasco da Gama. He also, see, he reached India like this, Vasco da Gama. He discovered sea new and Magellan and Cano, Columbus route, and Diaz. Many such great voyagers, they have discovered new routes from Europe. This was Europe and to India. Okay. From Europe, they went on new voyages like this and through Atlantic Ocean. See, these are all the sea routes which they have discovered. So to prove that Earth is not flat and it is around. Now they have taken up voyages. Suppose you take Vasco da Gama. He started and he traveled, and he started from west and he reached east. So later, now many people, Columbus did that kind of thing. Later even Vasco da Gama made his sea route like this, which shows that the Earth is circular, not like flat. So there were many beliefs which were in practice, which was completely disproved by these voyagers. So these were all the discovery of new sea routes during this period.